How many of you, this is your first time at one of our meetings? Wow, does this keep happening? that was like, I think, like, at least half. So for those of you who it's the first time here, we meet every month. We talk about mobile, obviously. We meet the fourth Monday, not the last Monday, the fourth Monday. We're modeled after an international organization called Mobile Monday, but we're not actually affiliated. To get a hold of us, we have a website, mobileportland.com. On Twitter, it's @mobileportland. We have a mailing list there. It's pretty low volume. It's basically just announcements from us. It's 2 to 3 emails a month. If you want to be involved in conversation, get in touch with people for help on your project or get information, we have a Google group right there. Let's see. So there's a lot of upcoming events. This was a kind of a small list, but so we've got tonight, there's Canadian Wireless Innovation Forum on the 27th. There's PDX Geek Girl Kickoff on the 29th. Marquette Portland, Breaking Development Conference. If you've never been there, that's a really good conference about mobile web design and development. Let's see here. The Startup Week in Portland in April. Mobilism Conference, which is another big design and development conference for mobile. And Jason gave me something that I've gotten already. Oh, and then Open Source Bridge at the end. So there's a discount code. It's OSBUGLUV, BUGLUV. So that's $100 off the registration for Open Source Bridge. And then if you need that, I think we'll probably post that somewhere.
They also have proposals until the 30th. So you can submit talks until the end of the week.
So yeah, if you didn't hear that, you're still taking proposals for that too for Open Source Bridge. So Urban Airship and Cloud 4 are sponsors, and I'll let Jason talk for a second.
Hey everybody, sorry I missed last month. And I'm very thankful to Matt for organizing this month's meeting. So before I talk, can everybody give him a round of applause? So is there anyone from Urban Airship here? No? Okay, well then I will make... Oh, yes. Do you want to talk about job openings?
No?
Okay. So there are a ton of open positions for Urban Airship. They're looking for good people who are working on iOS or backend. There's just a bunch of different positions. Please go take a look at it. As far as Cloud 4 is concerned, my co-founder Liza and I wrote a book, so if you haven't looked at the book, there's a copy around, so you can take a look, and we'd love for you to buy it. And if you have development projects or things related to mobile, that sort of stuff, we'd love to help out. And that's it. I'll let that continue.
Okay. Let's see here. So now we give you a couple seconds to talk about any job openings or announcements you have. Just raise your hand and I'll come around with the mic so that we can hear everybody.
Hi, I'm Will D. Sierra with Azad. We are an IT consulting firm in Beaverton. We've been here in Portland for about 20 years, and we're looking for a user experience designer for Beaverton for a product development, in a product development, research, and development environment. If any of you are interested, I'd be more than happy to speak with you for this position or other positions in the area. Thank you.
Hi there, I'm Stuart Solari, and wanted to let you know Portland Code Camp is scheduled for the 2nd of June, Saturday the 2nd. It's free and open to the public. The website just went up this morning, which means there are no sessions on it yet. We are a great place for you to talk about a project that you've worked on, a technology, a cool tool, anything like that. We're all about every technology, vendor, platform, anything that makes you as a software developer tick. So portlandcodecamp.org, work on either one, get you there, and sign up and think about submitting a session and coming in and telling your peers what makes you excited about software.
Cheryl Maloney with Tech4. We're looking for developers to do both front-end and back-end native and non-native app development. So check us out on tech4agency.com. Marilee Schillinger with In Sequence. Here at Portland in the US Bank Tower, we are an interactive TV development, software development company, and we currently have .NET and .NET server side position and UI position.
I'm Davey Ashoff, and I'm one of the founders of eCentive. We provide a product that allows customers to use tools like Groupon to then capture those customers and make their own offers to them later. We have clients throughout the nation now, a working product. We're looking for Java developers who are entrepreneurship-minded. Thanks so much.
So when we're all done,
sorry for the power
just
outage.
Get your two chips up, drop them in, you can go over to Meeple twice for the same person, put them in the jars up here, and we'll tally them up, and the winner will get a bottle of wine.
Each person should have two chips.
Yes.
If you don't have two chips, I will run around.
Yeah, no ballot box stuffing, please. This is not Chicago. I guess
we're
so I guess we're gonna get set up for miCoach.
Training focused on cardio training, that's what fitness. Okay, what we've now done is added
strength and flexibility training. So where it helps to answer the question, like how do I get fitter, tighter, leaner, you know, how do I lose weight, and basically get more flexible, that sort of thing. So what we're going to show today is that the advances we made to miCoach. So let me show you. This is the miCoach screen if you haven't seen it. Typical thing is that the go section is where you go and you do a workout, whether it's a cardio workout, a strength and flex track, lets you track your history and achievements and that sort of thing. Explore lets you look at some market information because they need some of this market information. And settings is your typical settings.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
oh,
just
oh. That's my show. Oh, yes. Actually, okay. All right. Okay. Oh, so I'm not doing it right. They don't let us out too often here. So. Okay, so we're going to take you through some of the basics of doing a strength and flex workout. So this screen here is your list of workouts, and what it does is list any strength and flex plan you may have set up on the website, or also a cardio plan. So listed here, you can see a couple things. One is there's a workout at the top. It says today's workouts. And I just happen to schedule a strength and flex workout, coincidentally, just for today, so I can demonstrate that. Below there, you can see there's these big bubbles, these two big bubbles. One is your strength and flex plan, and there's a cardio plan, so I have configured, set up on the website these plans. And then down below is just a smattering of different workouts that I just happen to have in this particular account. So if I, for example, if I look at one of these plans, the strength flex plan, you'll see here's a sequence of plans, one after another, workouts one after another. That is the order in which you should do this particular fitness plan. And this particular plan, in my case, is called a maximized strength. Okay? And it's a general fitness plan. Also here in the second bubble, just to show you real quick, is the cardio plan. And this is a little bit different. Cardio training for us is basically interval training. You train to coach yourself, or we coach you to particular fitness zones, whether it be heart rate or pace coaching, and that's what's been on the market since 2010. So let's take this workout here, the strength and flex workout, and once you select it, we give you a couple setup options where you can set up your playlist for music, get that configured. If you have a heart rate sensor connected, I actually have a heart rate sensor connected, so I can record my heart rate, compute calories and stuff like that during the workout. We also have a quick little setting there that lets you switch units between metric and pounds, which is important because if you travel, I don't think many people travel, you go to gyms, and some gyms use pounds and some use kilograms. So this is a nice convenient switcheroo that you can, on the fly, just change. So next screen here.
Heart rate sensor.
So she's got my heart rate sensor, she knows. Okay, so this is the preview of the workout we're gonna do. And so what we do here is you can see there's a coach note. Coach note is the note that sort of gives you information about what's going to happen in this particular workout. Okay. Next up down below is a list of the equipment you're going to need for this workout. Okay, so we'll give you a quick little synopsis of what's going to be available. And this is important too, because like if you're in a gym, if many of you work out in a gym, when it gets busy, like 6 o'clock, you're in there, man, there's a lot of people there, you got to kind of time it, so you sort of have to work your way to get to the right machines and stuff. So. This sort of gives you a prep of what's happening. And then we show you down below the different sections of the workout you're going to do. When it comes to strength training, we focus on a couple different areas. There's like what we call pillar preparation, there's movement preparation, there's strength and power, there's regeneration, and some others. And so this sort of gives you a preview. So if you tackle one of these, it opens up and you begin to see some of the different exercises, a little thumbnail. Tells you what you're going to do, a specific exercise, like how many reps in time. And you can pop these guys open, just kind of scroll through them. I can see them over here. So I'll let you get a feel for what's coming down the bike. Like for example, here this one's going to be a circuit. You're going to do sets, two sets of a couple different exercises. So once you're ready to go, you can start workout. Okay, now you're in the workout. We present the workout as a series of what are like cards. Okay, people can just flip through, and they can just do each of those exercises on each different section. That's a training component begins with a big circular dot and a color. The color conveys within the miCoach world some of the intensity of that work that you're going to do. So this says here we're going to start pillar preparation for 10 exercises. So what you can do is just swipe the first card. It's the first card. It shows you a thumbnail of the exercise there. and information about it. So what you want to do, if you're interested, you want to see play the video, we can just play the video on the card there so you can see the, you know, see that action. If you need to see a bigger part of the video, you can just zoom it out full screen so you can see it like that. Now associated with each exercise is a bunch of information about what you should expect or what the coach wants you to do. So there's a tip about what you should do with that exercise. There's some information that tells you to feel it. Basically says what you should feel when you go and do this exercise. Okay? And then there's specific instructions on that exercise. Go back here. So that's how you can easily see the actual exercise. Once you're on there, you can also, if you want, flip the card over. And you can see the same kind of information, so you don't have to go full screen video if you don't want to. So you can see specific information, instructions and stuff there. Go back. When you're on the card, you can see, it'll tell you the reps and the weight and things like that. And you can change this if you want. Like, for example, say I'm not going to do 10, I'm going to do 15 today, so just go ahead and put in 15. I could record. And if I want to say, yeah, 7 pounds, that's really like, I'll go to 23 pounds or something like that. Okay, then you can do that. So then the normal thing is when you're done the exercise, you check it off. Let's check. Now we slide on the next card. Okay, so that lets you keep track of, you know, which ones you've done. If you ever had a problem, you didn't like it, I want to do it again, I want to change something, just untap it and go over there. Okay? So basically, that's the series. So the cards are laid out, the exercises are laid out just as the coaches want you to do them. So if you come to like a circuit, they're going to give you, have you go through exactly what it is. Okay, so as you can go through, you can, we have timed exercises. For example, a little timer, it counts down 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And then, you know, it's going to actually do the 30 second timer. One of the things we have too, since you can skip around and stuff, is we have an overview here. That's why you just tap it on the lower left, and you'll see it'll give you a 30,000 foot view of the cards. Okay, so here they are, and you can scroll around and see, you know, like if you want to skip around, then you get certain equipment, and you can just jump on a paper card, click on it, the bullseye goes there, and now you're on that card. If you want to go back out, you just pop back out. You can actually zoom these over. But you can zoom these up so you can read them a little better and scroll around and that sort of thing. And then, let me come back. One of the things I want to show you too is like when you come into a circuit, such like this, circuit preview, you're going to do multiple exercises in a given circuit. You'll see that there's a circuit preview card gives you information about the exercise you're going to do and the weights and stuff like that. And then you just you know, plug through all you want. And when you're all done, hit end at any time. And then we'll give you some information at the end. Total weight lifted, you can rate your workout, you can add a note to your one if you want, that sort of thing. And then we'll also give you some information, you can see what you actually did there, you know, what you completed, what you checked off, and that sort of thing. Let's see what's about 30 seconds. Okay. Let's see what else we can see about that. So yeah, the idea is that you know, we're trying to answer that question for fitness, you know, for strength and flexibility training that we did with cardio training. So thanks.
Questions? Go around real quick.
Yeah.
Sorry, first.
So given that with the cardio training you guys did a really good job of using audibles, like especially the first Nokia phone, iPhone back a couple years ago. Are you guys sending cues over the headphones versus having to look at the device?
Right, no, not for this. There's other than beginning to work out, they didn't work out, that's it. There's no audible coaching to it. One of the reasons is because it's fairly complicated, there's a lot of instructions going into it. You know, you get an exercise that someone wants to do and stuff. And so we sort of looked at that and said, you know, it's probably too much to tackle right out of the gate. We thought it would just be too much for you.
Last question here. Oh, okay.
No. Have you looked at helping physical therapists and occupational therapists use the same data with their patients?
Not specifically. We, you know, the whole realm of supporting health and physical therapy and that sort of thing is really important, and obviously it's really big, but you know, for our specific focus, it's mostly been on sport, so we haven't really focused on the healthcare, you know, specific aspect of it. So certainly down the road, we hope that, you know, one day when people can develop their own training plans, maybe in conjunction with their doctor or their therapist, then they could potentially create those workouts on the miCoach website, download their phone, and actually go and do them. You know, that way, you know, it could be a nice merge or meld of the medical side plus, you know, our side of sport, really facilitate people's work. Because we have literally, I think there's like maybe 500 different exercises that are available, you know, ranging, you know, through all kinds of movement strength. So that certainly is a possibility, but not what we're totally focused on right now.
So my question is, why does Adidas do this, and what does Adidas get out of building an app like this?
Sure, yeah, I mean,
selling it.
Yeah, I mean, for us, the app is free, I mentioned that, but yeah, I mean, for us, Adidas is, you know, we're all about, you know, making an improvement, an impact in people's lives. I mean, we hope people will like the product, we hope people will find that it's very useful. I mean, the content that we have in here is a merger of content from Adidas and Athletes Performance. I'm not familiar with Athletes Performance, but it's a group that, you know, trains elite athletes in the world. And you know, so the focus is it's really good content. And so we're hoping that, you know, people will see the value in that and you know, use it, take it to heart. I mean, you know, we've had a lot of people who, you know, have never really done much fitness-wise, have picked this up and actually followed a plan and actually run like a 10K or, you know, lost weight or done whatever, and it's really gratifying. And I think we're hoping that if they feel good about it, then obviously that translates to shoes and apparel and sort of embracing the Adidas brand. So, you know, that's pretty much what we're doing.
I have a question. Two questions, actually. How do you differentiate yourself from Nike Plus? And also, I know that I think you used some microchip technology in your original iteration with the cardio stuff. And are you looking to maybe do that with some of the strength training, use some motion sensors and things like that?
Okay. So for Nike Plus, I mean, the biggest distinction, I mean, initially, the app came out, it was GPS based, you know, so you do like pace training. And then we added heart rate support. And so our biggest difference is that, you know, we're coaching you to actually reach your goal. You know, there is a fitness tracking app. You know, you go outside and you run around and you do your thing, and that's great. But at the same time, as you run around and stuff, am I doing the right thing? You know, am I running far enough or fast enough or whatever, you know? Where here we're saying, hey, if you follow this plan, you're going to get better. I mean, you're going to reach your goal. And so that's sort of like the key difference there. Initially, when we came up with miCoach, we released the Pacer product, you know, which was a built-in microchip. You know, you put it on your belt, and it worked with a stride sensor and heart rate monitor. You know, and that product is still out there today. And what we did with mobile is we said, well, hey, you know, I mean, obviously mobile is a much pervasive, you know, much bigger market. Right? You can reach a lot of people with it. So we still, you know, intend to look at focused, dedicated hardware in some cases where it makes sense, particularly, you know, for other types of movement, people like, you know, doing, you know, basketball and running and, you know, doing very short movements and stuff. They want to know how high do they jump or how fast do they move, and that sort of thing for their training. So certainly we're going to look at more of those you know, down the road, but the attraction here with mobiles is simply we can reach so many people.
Okay, we're going to do one more.
I was just wondering what your engagement is versus right when people download it, I can see them probably using it, but then what's the follow-on? Do you see people actively using it over and over again, or do you see people fall off afterwards because it's fitness?
Yeah, exactly. It's a mixed bag. I mean, you know, there's a lot of people that just download it because they're curious, and they kind of go, oh, what is this thing? And they check it out, no, it's not for people to do it, or it's too complicated, or whatever, you know. You know, I think roughly of the people that download, you know, you get probably 15-20% of people that actually stick with it and actually kind of take it to heart and use it, you know. I mean, some people will do stuff for a while and then they'll drop off because they're not interested or whatever, you know. So it's not a huge number by any stretch, you know, in terms of percentage-wise, but, you know, for those people that that do stick with it, that, you know, they get a lot out of it. So it's, for at least for, you know, say enough society or others, you know, it's hitting there their needs.
Okay, that's it. So thank you. So next up is AppThwack. Let's get it set up.
My name is Trent Peterson, and I'm here with my co-founder, Pawel, Wojnarowicz. We are the company Trellis Automation, and we just recently quit our day jobs to do this all the time. So, we have worked together for the past 6 years, and we have done nothing but automation, specifically system automation, like multiple devices interacting together. And we're now taking sort of our knowledge, and we're looking to do this and expose it to everybody in an easy to follow way. Everybody like, hears automation, but getting started in it is a little more difficult. Okay, so our first product that we're you know, bringing out is AppThwack, and what AppThwack is on-demand automated app testing on real devices, and this sits on top of a backend that we developed called Trellis, which I will get into in a second. Today it's Android only, but we are moving towards supporting iOS and Windows Phone as well. So maybe we first talk about why did we start with Android, and if anybody does Android development, I think like the answer is maybe kind of obvious. One is that if you're doing development, you're using the tools provided by Google, the output varies from phone to phone, version to version, if you're using Logcat, the like output in different formats, etc. We also have the problem of multiple handset manufacturers, so we have tablets, and we have phones, and soon we have TVs, and all sorts of things, right? And then on top of this, we have multiple versions of Android, and we have people locked into their carriers, and so they're not updating their Android versions, right? And so now we have a huge market, and we have people all over the place, and we have to support all of these, right? And there are tools to help us, but you know, they're not foolproof. And so we end up with reviews in the market that are either device-specific or form factor-specific, you know, problems with visualization, and others. Okay, so a typical development setup looks something like this, right? I mean, obviously, depending on shop, you know, the setup is a little different, but we start with emulators, we have one or more devices, and this is where, you know, you differentiate on the actual shop, how many devices you have to develop on, and maybe it's your personal one, maybe you have a cache locally that you know you use. You push it to the market, where it goes out to, right now in the US, we have about 80 or so provided by the carriers, plus you know at least that in legacy devices. And if you look on the global market, we have all sorts of devices that aren't offered by the carriers, but you can buy off of wherever. So our solution is AppThwack, and AppThwack lets you develop against real devices so that when you push to the market, you've already seen these devices. You know your app will at least perform. Right? And we come with some static test content, which we'll show in the demonstration, to at least like test the basics, and then you can go more in depth and actually use your own custom tests. So real quick on the sort of the back end here, and this is the where we spend the most time, is we have this thing called Trellis. And Trellis is an automation platform, and you won't be able to see what this says, but it's essentially it's an object-oriented way of scripting system interactions. So in this example, we do something like, we take two phones, we install an app on both of them, and we tell them to communicate to each other, right? And we do this in one script, and it's object-oriented, where you're like, phone1.installApp, phone2.installApp, and so on. Now, this is written in Python right now, and moving forward, everything is so abstracted that we can write adapters, and we can support any scripting language. Okay, so that's kind of besides the point. What really happens here is once we push this test into, or we call it a job, it's not test specific, we push it into Trellis, now Trellis goes into its device pool and it will pull a couple devices, and in this case our script requires two phones, And in this case, we've told it that we're running against Android. So it's going to run it against two Android phones, right? And it's going to tell them to talk to each other, and we're going to get our results. Now, the underlying functionality is abstracted to the point where we write a single script, but this could just as easily be iPhones down below, right? From a scripting standpoint or an automation standpoint, it doesn't really matter, or it doesn't have to matter. And everything is distributed. So we can have Trellis instances talking to Trellis instances, and they're geographically separated. And this is important because when we talk about a tool like AppThwack, which is the app testing service that we have, it talks to Trellis, and it talks to it in multiple locations. We have some that are running on EC2, running against emulators, and we have some that we host in our own labs on real devices, right? And you as a user, like, you don't have to script for this, you don't have to take this into account, it just works. And the technology is actually agnostic to what it's using, so it's not mobile specific even, right? This could just as easily be car track, and we could be talking about cars. Basically, we can automate anything that has an interface, but you know, the important thing here is that we do system automation, like syncing things together. And now Pawel's going to give an actual demonstration of AppThwack.
Hi, my name is Pawel. Well, like Trent mentioned, we worked together for quite some time now. And I'll give you a quick overview of how the service actually works in its current stage, right? It's still under development. So we started logged in, and we end up on the homepage that essentially shows you some test results from all the projects that you as a user belong to. And let's go directly to one of those projects. So I'm going to go into my project, and this view essentially shows you some, you know, high-level trends for your tests. Essentially, five plus test runs, and you can see a nice graph that kind of shows you, you know, passes, failures, warnings for your test. And down below there is the area that allows you essentially to either drag and drop or just upload your APK, right? Like Trent said, and we're on it right now. And let's do this. When we upload the APK, what happens is that AppWork schedules a number of tests and trends, right? And we have, for this demo, we have three simple tests: install, launch, and uninstall. We capture a bunch of data. You know, we actually verify whether application installed, launched, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we run those tests in parallel on a number of devices. Right now, for this demo, we have five physical devices in our lab, as well as three emulators hosted on EC2. And the moment the APK is uploaded, it's picked up by Trellis, and right now we can go into details and see exactly what's happening. When you look at the details of a test run, right, there's three ways to view it. You can see just some high-level highlights, you can see by device and by test results view. The highlights will just show you high-level pass, fail, error, warning counters, right, as well as all of the issues that were found during the test run. The APK uploaded, called Hello Trellis APK, the one we wrote that will randomly generate some issues, so hopefully as soon as we start getting into the launch test, we will see issues come up. If you go to by device, you actually see that installation test passed on almost all devices already. Here's the devices that we're using, and launch test already started right in some of them. And this is the way to essentially view all of the results, no matter whether they're pass or failures. Let's wait just a second, and once the launch tests are completed, some of them should fail. So as you can see on Samsung Vibrant, that is actually a physical device sitting in our lab, there was an exception code during the launch. And let's go into more details, right? So once you see a failure, and by the way, I can go back to highlights, right? And highlights, in addition to high-level content, shows me all the failures. So this is the great place to start. You start testing your app. If you are interested just in like drilling down to the warnings and failures, you just start there. And let me go into the more details for Vibrant. And here is some high-level information about this particular test on the particular phone. You can see some, you know, high-level failure message right at the top, some general information capturing your test, as well as what exactly happened during this test, right? And as an application developer, you know, you see that your app crashed when, you know, this was essentially force close, right? You hit on, you might want to look at a screenshot, and the screenshot actually shows that this application forced unexpectedly. And you can say why, because you go down there and in the log you see actually full stack trace, right? So this is just examples of information that we can extract when we run a test, right? So we can capture screenshots, we can capture some data. For example, we can capture a launch time, which in this case took 51 milliseconds. If you are an Android developer, you're probably familiar with this, which is a logcat. We capture essentially a full logcat from the device, and you can go and pull down and view it message by message and see exactly what happened. So, of course, you can drill down not only into fail tests, but also into pass tests. So, you know, there's different ways of viewing data. This is all about the demo. You can go and go to our site. We have a live demo site linked to our main site where you can actually upload APK, some predefined APK yourself. One of the examples is the APK that uses robot for this, because like Trent mentioned, we're a test agnostic. Those are just like few examples, but we already allow to upload an APK as well as a test APK with it that has the chain in it, right? So if you get a volume test or any other tests for your Android app, you can run them on our infrastructure as well. And a few more words about where we're going. We're starting a free beta very soon. So feel free to drop us a line or register on our website if you're interested in participating. You know, we're adding more stuff all the time, improving our content, adding new tests, adding performance tests, graphing results, for example, running some random UI action to see how your app behaves from a performance standpoint, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we're adding more stuff all the time, and I think that's it. My timer.
Thank you very much.
So what is the situation, business situation for AppThwack? Are you guys and how hard is it to say that without like sounding like the duck from AppThwack? No, but like, are you guys funded? Like, what's going on in terms of your startup?
Yeah, so everything is bootstrapped right now, and we are doing everything out of pocket, and that's kind of the way that we're going right now. And yeah, we're looking to, we have a few different business models, and it's something consulting work is, you know, contractual work and so
on. I don't think it'll be long. Mm-hmm.
Right here.
How do you scale it?
I'll come around, Dale.
Yeah, I'm wondering how far this goes, because this is all really interesting when you're showing these launch tests and everything else, but I'm wondering, first of all, there's a lot of interesting questions about how you're loading APKs on like phones that don't support side-loading APKs. Or even past that for interaction tests, like if you move out to iOS and these sorts of things that don't necessarily allow you to script these kind of things, how are you handling that short of actually altering the devices in some way that may be invalid in these tests?
So yeah, there's a lot of opens in this space, and just today we talked to you guys from the subject side on it's like how you guys want to handle iOS, and it's, you know, we don't know yet, right? You know, we hope that we'll find a solution. We focus on Android, A, because it's an obvious problem, too, because, you know, it's like, it's probably easier to solve it, right, in like a programmatic way, right? But yeah, I mean, I guess I don't have a good answer for this.
Yeah, I think we definitely haven't, you know, we don't want these devices to all be rooted or jailbroken or whatever. It, you know, right, they need to be, someone stocks that the tests aren't like running on devices that don't represent the actual end user, right? And yeah, from an Android perspective, this hasn't been an issue for us, you know, at all.
Sure.
Yeah, definitely as we move forward towards iOS, it's going to be something that we're tackling.
Okay. So I'm just curious how you guys are going to be scaling, what that looks like on the hardware side. You mentioned that you're running some of this on devices in the lab, you know, like hundreds of devices in the lab at this point. What does that look like?
So right, I know I wish it was hundreds. Right now, you know, we have about five or so, and we've acquired them all in the last week. And we're trying to be extremely smart about it, right? So we go and we look at the market, and we can tell like which devices sort of have more errors than the others. And Netflix just recently blogged about how they've limited their testing to about 20 devices. But if you read the comments on this post, then you see a bunch of people wanting them to add their devices to this list too because they have problems. Yeah, and then scaling this is going to be interesting, especially from a cost perspective, because, you know, it's not like we just spin up another, you know, EC2 instance and all of a sudden we have another go, right? For emulated devices, this works fine. For a lot of phones, you can find them on an emulator, but definitely not all of them. So as we move forward, I mean, everything is sort of up in the air how scaling will work. But the one thing is that we're trying to keep the tests to run under a minute. So when you drop the lab on, it's 1 minute on the lab in total. And so far, this seems to be perfectly fine. Once it's installed, everything's really fast, right? Installation is usually the longest thing. Running through the app. And screenshot takes a long time to do, but we're working on this.
Do you think that manufacturers with less what you're doing and want to empower it? Or do you think this is something that we're here to
do? I mean, hopefully, yes. I mean, that's our assumption. Both manufacturers and Google, right? You would think they know about this problem, right? And they don't have a solution. So,
Yeah, and the one other thing is I think that the carriers, you know, and the handset manufacturers, I think they already do encourage services somewhat similar to this. There are services, you know, that already exist where, you know, for instance, like Sprint has a development lab that's hosted by some company, but basically you rent time on the device and you log in through like a VNC type, you know, interface. And this is not what we're after, right? I mean, we're not looking to, you know, at least right now, to like rent devices, especially because it's incredibly expensive. If you look at the services out there, that's not there, right? This is more to expose these devices, you know, like I said, for about a minute, maybe more, but, you know, fairly like limited, right? And to just get for our basic tests and to get enough information out of this that it's, you know, somewhat comprehensive and from a development standpoint, it's useful.
One more.
I know that I would find this extremely useful because you're doing something that's similar to like Blaze.io for the web, but a lot more information. So I'm really excited about using this. I'm wondering if you guys are coming to MediaConf, because I know a lot of other people would be excited about maybe playing with some things.
I don't think we're even going to. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next up is Constrict Sky with Cyclopedia Britannica.
So, Mobile Portland, thanks for having us. Appreciate the opportunity. My name is Kiel Bruckner. I'm Vice President of Technology for Concentric Sky. I'm here with Charles Augustine, our lead iOS developer. No poaching. So we're kind of crashing your party. We're located in Eugene. I'm here watching because I can't talk on the mic. Like I said, we're down in Eugene, we have a kegerator too. A lot of fun, a good place to work, so we're hiring as well. Areas of focus for us are obviously mobile, that's why we're here, but we do a lot of work in the web space and the Java enterprise space as well. We've been really fortunate and we've been able to work with a lot of big world brands like the World Bank, National Geographic, NASA, and we're here today to talk about Encyclopedia Britannica. The app we recently built for them. The relationship with Britannica started a couple of years ago. We built a line of kids apps for them that are doing very well in the iTunes App Store. They've since been translated to Portuguese, Spanish, and French, and Korean. So they've had a lot of success with those, and that's partly what led to the Encyclopedia project with Britannica. So they've been getting a lot of press lately because they recently decided to stop printing the encyclopedia. I think, you know, 244 years ago was when they started publishing the encyclopedia, so it was a pretty big deal. And that's why we started working with them about a year ago to build the encyclopedia. So we built it for iPad and iPhone. And so far, it's also doing pretty well. It's been featured on iTunes a few times, recently won an Appy Award, and Walt Mossberg actually had a few good things to say about it. So Charles is going to walk you guys through a demo of the iPad app. Like I said, there's also an iPhone version of it, so do take a look at that if you're interested in that.
All right, like Kay was saying, it's difficult to use the iPad and hold the mic at the same time, so I'm just going to try and stand here.
if I look away from it, you can yell at me and I'll try and, you know, be out of the way. All right, so we went ahead and did a couple of different things. First, you get sort of a search interface. The guys at Encyclopedia Britannica really liked the Bing UI, so that was sort of the focus here. Gives you access to a couple different things. We've got our general browser interface. We have a My Britannica section along the top there. There's a This Day, which will let you see kind of events and historical things that happened on this day and various years of the past. And of course, searching for articles. So one of the main challenges in this application was none of this data comes with the application when you download it. It's all pulled asynchronously while you're using the application. And our goal was to present the user with a user experience that didn't make them wait a whole lot to get the content. Okay? So can you guys hear me back there? China is one of our test articles because it's about a 5 megabyte XML document, which is a whole lot of XML. And I think there's something like 200 different images that also are part of the article. So I'll pull that up here, if I can touch it. There we go. So you can see it's streaming right now and rendering pages. I don't know if you can actually see that on the fly there. It's up to about 300. This article is extremely large, like I said, 5 megs of XML. But as you go, I guess I could have shown you while it was actually streaming. I'll rotate it so it repaginates. You know, as it's streaming, you can still use the app. And in the background right now, it's rendering more pages, and it's doing all this sort of on the fly. We did that with a number of different technologies. We were fortunate in that we could use a relatively recent version of iOS, so we were able to use Grand Central Dispatch. Developers in the house might know what I'm talking about. It's a very useful library for very low-level kind of asynchronous work. It gives you very nice serialized dispatch queues, and you don't have to worry about how many threads are backing in or the device it's running on. And Apple will sort of hopefully do the right thing and you know, give you some reasonable thread pool or dispatch it to OpenCL if that's available and appropriate or whatever else. So that was kind of a nice win for us. For older technology, though, like this uses libxml2. And again, anyone who's used libxml2 knows it's kind of a beast. So we had to do some interesting work with kind of lower level foundational frameworks in iOS to get the data to come in asynchronously and then be able to parse the XML sort of a string-based manner also asynchronously with libxml2, get that back on the main thread and then hand it off to our Cortex frame setter, which is running on Grand Central Dispatch queue and all this sort of asynchronous stuff. So it was a pretty fun problem to work on. Another of the things we did here was a link map. So you can kind of explore related topics to the article you're looking at. So you can see here we've got China in the middle and various related topics, and I can sort of navigate through this little web and zoom in and out and whatnot. We have a fun little kind of repulsion physics simulation going on here, so you can kind of mess with it and, you know, drag stuff around. And then if you find an article you like, you want to know a little more, we didn't eliminate cycles. Spin off forever on China if you want to. You just kind of hold it down and you can go to the new article. And it will move quickly. This one was very cool, actually. So, yeah, we had a lot of fun with that too, playing with a little fizzy stuff. For this day page, as you can see here, we've got sort of events of this day. Apparently, Mike Tyson was sentenced to prison in 1992 on this day. That's very exciting. And then, you know, a whole huge list of people that were born on this day. And what's cool about this is you can link directly back into the articles that are related to those people and stuff in the encyclopedia. So it's a little bit more interactive way of dealing with the content than what you get with the dead tree version. Of course, also, in My Britannica, you know, you have recently viewed things, saved articles, we saved the quarterly article here. So anything that's saved is available offline. You don't need an internet connection, you cache it a little bit. We're actually able to exploit our caching mechanism we have just for doing this kind of re-rendering. Cable fail. We were able to use our just kind of general usability caching and import the saved articles relatively easily, so that worked out really well. We've also got some fun little things here, like we've got this little image card deal, and you can see large versions of the images as well. So I mean, that's the classic Portland picture there from the Rose Garden. And we had some fun doing some other animations, just like this little page animation that you saw earlier. You can just browse through a giant index of things like Wikipedia or some of mine. The monetization, you can't really see it here because I can't log out, but if we use the, of course, the in-app purchasing that Apple provides to do a subscription-based monetization scheme. So you pay $1.99 a month to access this content, and EB is constantly doing their editorial stuff, updating articles and all that good stuff. I think we're even trying some non-subscription-based models, maybe in other markets too.
In Australia and the UK.
Yeah, so trying a couple different things in that vein. The subscription process was kind of interesting to work with. I don't know if any of you have ventured down that path, but their sandbox environment is pretty intense. That's about the gist of it. So, are we going to questions?
Questions?
Okay, so I saw like you had some sort of discovery stuff with the links off topic and stuff. But have you guys thought about like other means of discovery when it comes to content and how to implement that?
So initially when we put this together, we were exploring the idea of a trending piece. Looking at the Twitter stream to figure out what articles might be trending and highlighting some of those on the homepage. That didn't happen. Maybe it'll happen at some point in the future. But so, to answer your question, we did think about some other things.
The other thing which we do that you can't do with the dead tree version is there are of course live links in the text. It's kind of hard to see. You won't have to put it down to touch it, but you can hit any of these links and just bounce around between different articles that might be relevant. So you can go down the rabbit hole in that sense as well. Well, Encyclopedia Britannica actually has an entire web version of this. And so we were, in some sense, feature-driven based on what their website supports. And hyperlinking, obviously, is a big piece of the website. So that was my favorite.
I'm just wondering how smart is your search engine really is. For example, you enter like China, you show like 400 pages. I don't think I know how to read that 400 pages. I want to have kind of try like China and America and see how narrow down the subject that possibly interested.
Yeah, the search results aren't actually that great at the moment, and it's because we want it to be real time. We're sort of limited in how complex our search algorithms are, and that's actually all handled on the Britannica side, and their web services do that. It is full text, but I don't know if it has inter-article relationships. One thing I didn't show here, which I can bring up real quick, is there actually is a table of contents that you can look at. Oh, that's an interesting fading there going on. That might be an iOS 5 thing. So, you can easily kind of skim through the article to some degree. Also, if you just kind of do this little scrubber thing down here, you can kind of get a sense for where you're jumping in. But that's sort of my most inspired. Table contents might be better.
Yeah, it's a really nice app. I've been playing with it since it came out. Is there an institutional authentication method for logging in?
That's actually in the works, and it'll be IP-based, I believe. This version actually includes that I have on this iPad here. But that's definitely something that the next version should have.
Do you know how they're going to do that? We're working with a lot of different vendors right now at a university, and there are all different ways that they're choosing to authenticate, and some are much, much better than others. Some are terrible.
Well, I actually implemented it, so I know pretty much exactly how it works. it's going to be IP-based, and basically the authentication token is going to exist for a couple of months once you visit, or once you open the app from an IP address that has institutional access. So if a student goes to campus and they have access from that IP address, then they can go home and use it at home for 3 months before it'll block them out. That's the gist of it. It is entirely IP-based, unless, I mean, there's also, like, if you have a login to the Britannica website, which maybe some institutions do, you can just log in that way. I can't show that because I'm logged in and there's no way to log out at the moment, so.
I was just wondering, when you were working with the client, did they clearly define the target demographic for the app, and did they also kind of have a clear understanding of the use cases for this app, and did that influence your design decisions?
A little yes and a little no. It's always a challenge, in my opinion, when you're working with somebody who is like really feature-driven based on their website, to get them into the mobile mindset. So we did our best to steer them towards what we thought was best, and not just like what they had on their website. Sort of a real high-level answer to your question, I guess. But
this is being strained. I think Charles did a good job of answering that question. I think they have, you know, obviously quite a bit of information, you know, about the demographics, but you know, again, a lot of it was influenced by their experience with the website, which doesn't necessarily translate to the iPad, so.
Two more.
What do you call the tree chart? Again, I didn't catch that.
It is called the link map, this little button in the upper right, says link map.
When you guys initially designed that, did you price out for haptic response? Was there a reason why you may not have gone with it? This question.
You say haptic response in the sense of like vibration, or you know, the vibration control you get on an iOS device is pretty limited. You can kind of just make it vibrate or not. So I never honestly thought about it. Although we did go through like three iterations of various different physics-y engines and things, so.
One more? Okay. Oh, sure. Okay.
How about EPUB 3? What do you think of that as a standard for other platforms?
It looks really cool to me. You know, of course, Apple now has their iBooks, which I believe is a sort of a proprietary extension based on EPUB 3. We wanted to go with more of an application model for this, obviously. I mean, EPUB is great, but it's a little bit more limited in the interactivity you get, unless you're going to go crazy with JavaScript widgets and iBooks offered. But you know, maybe they'll do it at some point.
Okay, thank you. Next up is Tweet a Beer.
Daniel Wood, I'm with 10-4, and this is Eric Radcliffe, and we we're about 5 blocks that way, so we are a local creative digital firm focusing on mobile and social strategy, design, and development. And as Cheryl mentioned earlier, we are hiring developers front and back end, so reach out to us if you're interested in beer and other things like that. So, what we did is put together a program, a self-promotional app, which was a lot of fun. We came out of the holidays, and about a week after, we got a call from a buddy of ours, Frank at Wagner Extra, which is a local PR firm that does a lot with Microsoft and other folks. And they wanted to work with us to develop something that they could talk about, show, and evangelize at South by Southwest. And if anyone that's familiar with the time frame, that's about 6 weeks after the holidays. So we decided that we wanted to do something together. And we came together and put some ideas on paper, figured out that we could do a collaboration with them, helping us to market and publicize what we were working on, and that we could, at 10-4, could put together some creative ideas, do the design development, and make it come to fruition. Something else that happened over the holidays was I was watching my Twitter feed go past and saw an interesting article from TechCrunch on a local startup called Chirpify. At the time it was called Sell Simply, and I like to keep an eye on what all the talented startups like these gentlemen are doing, because there are always some kernels of that, of things that we can build upon oftentimes with our clients. And so Chirpify was really an interesting idea. It is essentially a Twitter commerce platform, so it allows you to connect PayPal and Twitter together through a pre-approval mechanism that allows you to tweet money to other people. And the beauty of Twitter, as we mostly all know, is that you can follow people that you know, people that you admire, people that you've never met. And at South by Southwest, that is something that happens a lot, of connecting with people, hearing a great speech, seeing a terrific presentation, wanting to be able to connect with them. So when we were putting together some ideas, we came around a bunch of different concepts, and what really stood to rise to the surface was something that had some value, was targeted at the key demographic, which was us, as well as people following the following week on the music side, the film, and then growing exponentially from there to something that would hopefully scale not only in Austin, nationwide, but possibly even internationally. And so that's how Tweet a Beer came to be. So what Tweet a Beer is essentially what we discussed is being able to connect your accounts and send a virtual beer to anyone with a Twitter and a PayPal account. And what that is essentially it's like an e-card that goes across and also connects the money on the back end, $5 loosely earmarked for beer. You can use it for whatever it is that you like. But you're able to associate a reason, pick a spot. We pulled in many APIs, including Foursquare to recommend local venues that will quench people's thirst. And it's been a lot of fun. So let's go ahead and show you what this looks like. We're going to have Eric go ahead and buy me a beer. Wow, how convenient. And I would be buying everyone a beer, as Dana recommended earlier, but it's a little bit out of my budget, but I do come with swag. So after this, we've got some Twitter stickers up here that could definitely influence your vote on your way out. So all you need to do is get connected. So right now he's logged in as 10-4 at the top there.
Directly to you.
Sure. Yeah. So go ahead and he's going to put in my Twitter handle. Yeah, that's pretty simple. Yeah. And this is a mobile website we designed for mobile first and then extended that to iPad, desktop, everything along those lines. So that's the happy to column layout because it extended from the original mobile. So what you're seeing is the default view. One of the things that we did for Chirpify is Chirpify requires you to have the tweet formatted in a particular way for them to one, scan it and then process that. So it has to have pay the person X amount of dollars for something. And that is what Chirpify is based on. So right now, if you could hit send a beer and go, we wanted to make sure it was quick, simple, you could go into it. But it's much more fun to add a reason. So you can click down and select a reason. We had some stuff that has already been pre-populated for you. So Eric can pick any one of these that fits the occasion. We got to play with a great copywriter, an ex-alum of Portland, Simon Gens, to help us get some of the voices here. So it pre-populates one of them, and then you can go free-flowing from there. And adding a location, it defaults, knows where you are, suggests Deschutes, Brewery, Little Big Burger, looks at bars and restaurants in the near vicinity that have popular check-in values from Foursquare. And then you can actually go through and use the search feature if you want to buy someone a beer in, say, London, Sydney, anywhere around the world. So Foursquare helps to scale across that. And then you can visit your market for when, today, tomorrow, sometime soon. It's really more of an intention of buying someone a beer. And that was something that was really interesting to us is, while Chirpify had come out and started as an initial platform for buying and selling things, what was interesting was kind of the social connection of putting a layer of buying a virtual beer on top of it, because in society there's not a lot of areas that you can't really kind of buy someone a gallon of gas and have it be kind of a casual thing, pick up their coffee so much at a Starbucks, but buying a complete stranger a beer is okay in our society and something that quickly translates across most cultures, which we found as this thing started to scale around the world. So let's go ahead and buy that beer. So it's going to send them the beer money, and that's going to send a little notification. So I'm going to go ahead and collect this beer and let Eric tell you some more details about the app.
Why, thank you. What he is doing, as you can see, he is going to Twitter. The tweet comes with a bit.ly link. The bit.ly link sends you to a claim page where you can not only claim your beer, but also thank the person who decided that you needed vitamins totally. And there really isn't too much to do here. One thing, at some point we can go back to that page, it's just something kind of interesting we have, but what he's doing here is he's logging in, connecting with Chirpify, actually. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, because he's connecting with Chirpify. Because you have to have a Chirpify account, you have to have your Twitter account connected to your PayPal account, or for the transaction to come through, even if you're receiving. It redirects you back to the app. If you wanted to right now, you can just hit tweet, and it'll just send that generic thank you. But he knows I appreciate customized things, so there you go, tweet sent. What's happening here is there are two different logouts here. One just sort of takes you out of this particular session. The secure logout, what it does is it completely disconnects you from, it doesn't disconnect you, it revokes access from Chirpify. Chirpify access to your Twitter account. It just cuts that off. So you have a way of just completely getting out of the system. Otherwise, you're always connected with Chirpify, and some of you just pick up your iPad and say, hey, Twitter handle, and it would actually send a beer with your credentials. So that's one way to just sort of cut it off if necessary. Down on the bottom of this page, the previous page, I guess we'll, I don't know if you can go back. What we did near the bottom is, maybe not that one. I don't know. What we did is we enabled you to scroll through all of the previous beers that have been tweeted. They get kind of interesting, reading the reasons and the thank yous and stuff. Just sort of a little wackiness to keep people entertained after they have practiced tweeting beers to their friends. I would need to pull up my own tweet to see the thank you. But basically, that's just. It really isn't meant to be a complex application. The transactions are very simple, and once you're authenticated with Chirpify, you're connected, everything's going, you just tweet, 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 tweet. Just make yourself broke tweeting people beers. And our guys at South by Southwest almost did that. Didn't they? Yeah. They're not. So, yeah, there you go. Oh, yeah, this is the page. If you go to the bottom, this little scroller down here, you can go forward and backward and see the previous years and the following years that have tweeted through this service. It was a minor enhancement. There are a number of enhancements that we're sort of tossing about for future versions of Tweeted Beer, but can't really talk about them. So, that's pretty much it.
There you go. So I will show you that the money actually transferred.
We're up.
Okay, I will do that.
Thank you. Maybe someone will ask to see it. Thank you.
Getting the most optimal route between A and B. And so what we've done, we spent the last 2 years and $500,000 investing in the platform that addresses this critical issue. Now, there's a lot of different things that are out there that kind of look at one or different aspects of the problem, but we get right to the heart of it. And how we do that, okay, quick button. We have developed and just launched, we are now in open beta, an app that provides real-time traffic alerts and personalized, provides alternate route guidance and commuter cash for delays. A lot of people think of that last point as air miles for the rest of us. For those of you that spend more than 15 or 20 minutes a day in your vehicle, we now have an application for both iPhone and Android that help alleviate. In fact, to kick it off, we're in this promotional window right now for encouraging people to try out the application. We're providing an opportunity to unlock entries to win iPhones, iPads, and MacBooks. So for some of you that want to take advantage of the new iPad that's out there, let's see, where's the right button? Excellent. So what is it? I've got a demo I'll walk through here in just a moment. But at a very high level, we have an application interface that works for both iPhone and Android, as I mentioned, and a very extensive back end. And this is where the intellectual property is and what we've developed that's taken us really 2 years to get to where we're at. It includes what we call commute pays cash. This is a commuter cash. It's a virtual currency, and I'll show you how you can use that and redeem that. It provides real-time routes and traffic information that is specific to your route. And so what we do is we've got five different sources of information that we aggregate and provide a snapshot right to you before you head out the door. It's really designed, we don't compete with GPS systems. It's really designed for folks that have a residence that's at a different location than their home. I'm sorry, than their business. They spend more than typically 15 or 20 minutes a day between the two. We use GPS or location-based services. We've got alerts, and again, I'll show you how all this works in just a moment here. How we monetize the application, we have opt-in and opt-out advertising models that allow you to take advantage of hyper-local offers and promotions that are specific to your areas of interest. And again, I'll give you a couple of examples of that in just a moment. And we've done this in working with strategic partners. Some of you may be familiar with Inrix, another one of our key partners, Google, and Urban Airship has been instrumental in helping us with some of the technology and how we work within the app as far as push notifications. So we've got a business portal that allows merchants to provide relevant, global, timely offers and promotions to people that may be passing the place of business on a daily basis. And if I'm a user, I might want to just log in and check out specific promotions that might have opted in or taken advantage of, the current status, how much commuter cash I've earned. And then we've got an administrative portal that we use on the back end to administer all this. So the last slide before I jump right into the demo, this shows you how easy it is to get set up and run the commute pays application. So you can, in fact, we also have some little bookmarks before you head up. You can grab one. We'll have some out in front. You just download the commute pays app. The next step is you enter your commute, and it's basically it takes it to and from. And there's an assumption that you're at one of those two locations, or you can enter it. So it has that by default based on your location. It maps out what is typically 9 times out of 10 the route that you probably take. And then you can hit a button and actually add alternate routes. And then the other piece is you take a moment to set up an alert notification. And that is when you typically leave. If you know that I like to leave between 7 and 7:15, then you might want to get an alert around 6:50. You just basically say, going to and then coming from, I want a 10-minute. What it does is it takes a snapshot at that moment in time, based on your route, it gives you the most optimal or most efficient route between the two. And again, it's designed really for the commuter and perhaps the soccer mom that might have a typical route where she needs to take Susie to piano practice or Jim to soccer practice. And at that point, you just drive. Anytime you're commuting, you're earning commuter cash. And how you redeem that commuter cash, and again, I'll show you that in just a moment. And it's fun to see it click. It's just how quickly you can earn that commuter cash. Some of you might be thinking, well, that's a little similar to the points, perhaps, on Foursquare. The difference is that those points actually, as you probably know, expire after a few days, and they've got no tangible value associated with them. With these, you can actually cash them in and redeem them for special offers and promotions. So, and how you do that, it'll show up on the map. So with that, I'll go ahead and switch over to the demo of the app itself. And demoing it on an iPad, it actually works both on iPad and Android tablets, as well as the iPhone and Android. And voila, so we press this little trick. Can I just press the trick? Okay, so with this, and I can just press this, it says no signal. Do I need to do anything magic to switch it over?
Oh, it was there.
Just a loose connection.
Aha.
All right. As long as I can keep this plugged in. So I'm going to go ahead and open up the commute pace app. And with that, I can actually just simply log in with Facebook. And I'll punch in here. Let's see. I think I've got this set up for. Oh. Zoom in. Thank you. So I can go ahead and just log into my account and show you how the rest of the piece works. I'm actually really excited that we are just coming up. We have faster.
Okay, now you don't know how to connect, right?
Please, yeah, log in, give me some. So, here we go. With this, let me just pop back up. The first thing you see when you log in, actually when you open up the app, is that we're in this promotional window right now where you can win in our All Things Apple promotion. The next thing, so it's just a little pop-up thing, and then you just click the X and it goes away. And then it actually just walks you through how to set up and run the app. So the first piece of it here with the intro, and of course you can always skip through this, it reads the directions. But for the purpose of this, I'll just walk you through it very quickly. It tells you, first of all, you set up a home and an office address. And as I mentioned, what that does is it typically gives, for most folks, about 9 out of 10 times, it gives them the most likely route between the two. And at that point, there's a little plus. Let's see, down in the corner, it actually shows up here, and I'll show you on the interface in just a moment, to where you can enter alternate routes. And it gives you a couple little push pins, and you can simply move them and say, well, I could take this exit, or I could take this. And so you can very simply map out 2, 3, 4, alternate routes. And you can have multiple different commutes, by the way. So you might have different places you're going at different times. So the next thing you know gives you information about the commute delays. So with that, let me just skip to the last couple of things here real quick. It's very simple to set up an alert, and that is, you just basically said, I typically leave between X and Y, and then it will give you a little pop-up notification. Now, are there always delays, always alerts? No, but you've got a snapshot that gives you a confidence that knowing that route that you take is going to be the most optimal at that moment in time based on the traffic conditions. And then you can just post those in based on days of the week and get an advantage of customized local deals. One of the things that we found, actually, even for me personally, I always used to have a little bit of an edge when I got stuck in traffic, a little frustrated, and then I finally got there, and a lot of people struggle just with different elements associated with traffic. Now, even though I may still get stuck in traffic, what happens is the counteraction goes up incrementally. So you're getting even more commuter cash than you would have otherwise if you had just driven straight there. So it just, again, kind of takes the edge off a little bit. And you can gift it. It is a currency. Gift it, you can redeem it, and as we kicked off with our initial promotion, you can also take advantage of special offers and promotions. So, the last thing I will just show you, so contest description, one of the promotional windows I mentioned, information on the website, local deals, promotions, suggest to a friend. All right, so let me just with that go back right back to the app itself. So what these little grocery carts represent, no surprise, are these are actual promotional deals. We are just this week going to be announcing with a major national a special promotional offer for folks that have the app running, where they'll be able to take advantage of something free. I can't disclose what that is yet, but we'll be actually announcing that either later this week or next, just for dropping into a particular location. There's a lot more I could say, but I don't want to take any more time away because I imagine some of you may have a few questions. One important thing that I'll mention is that we're not doing anything to actively engage with the commuter while they're driving. It's a very important thing to mention. Safety is paramount. So what happens is when you want to, at any time you're in a static position, you want to look at the map, look at deals, locals, promotions, offers, it's all there. But just because you happen to be driving by a location and they have a special offer promotion, you're not getting a ping or a text message or anything like that. That is.